gentlemen.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Can I please have your attention?
Now showtime. Are you ready? Are you ready for Star Trek?
Let's find out. Ready, let's go.
What's up, Facebook Live? That's right. I am back at it again for another episode of DJ ROB Presents, Taking It Back. First, I want to thank you guys for watching last week's episode. A lot of comments, a lot of chats, a lot of questions after the fact. Yes, that was Michael Cooper of Confunction. Man, talented musicians. And speaking of talented musicians, we got another one. I am doing it again. And this friend of mine, and I call him a great friend, whenever I ask him to do something, hey, I need you to join my band. I need you to do my Christmas party. I need you to do some corporate events. I mean, exclusive corporate events. We're going to get into all that. But man, another talented musician. And like I said, we go back like an 8-track in the Cadillac with the seats back. I'm stumbling. I'm nervous. It's Paul Taylor, ladies and gentlemen. Paul Taylor. Give it up for Paul Taylor, my guest this week.
Man, ROB, pleasure is mine, my friend. Thank you so much.
We're going to do what we usually do. We're going to take it back. That means we're going to go to the beginning, mm-hmm. and we're going to go kind of to the past, and then we're going to go to the present. And ladies and gentlemen, he's got a new album coming out November 5th, and this is his 12th album release. This dude has been doing albums over 25 years. He's been touring for over 25 years, so he's putting in work. And yes, we can consider him a Vegas native. We know you're from Denver originally. We're going to talk about that. So let's go back to the very beginning, and we're going to talk about Denver. You're in school.
Yes.
And at 7 years old, you pick up the instrument, and the instrument is a saxophone.
Yes.
Tell us about that and how that happened.
So the funny part, Rob, about that whole situation, I have a younger brother named Bentley. So my parents got Bentley and I in organized activities, like most people get their kids into sports. But for us, it was band. So they came in one day and said, you guys want to play some music, play instruments? Sure, sure. Little did we know what would come after that. You know, a lot of practicing and all that stuff. But anyway, so they got us into this organization called the Denver Youth Musicians Gold Sash Band. So it was organized activities, like doing band. And they, they had fundraiser drives. They had, like, beginning band, intermediate band. The Gold Sash Band, the top level band. So we spent like from 7 to 16 doing that. And it taught, we had uniforms to wear and everything. So we did that. So the funny story is on the first meeting with the director, he has Bentley and I standing side to side. And he like looks you up and down and like says, Bentley, we're going to have you on clarinet. And Paul, we're going to have you on the saxophone. So that's the crazy story. I never even picked the saxophone. The director picked the saxophone.
But you loved it.
You know, I just went for it and tried it. You're like, you're just a 7-year-old kid, so might as well try it and just do it. And then
most of the kids wanted to do the drums and the guitar. And the saxophone, I think, is a difficult instrument. I tried to mess with it. I'm sticking to the drums.
You do get air sax, though. That's pretty good.
I'm good at air sax. I had to practice the air sax today. So, Paul, that Gold Sash Band, that was in elementary?
Yes, absolutely.
And tell us about that. And you met, I think you met the mayor.
Yes. So through that, I think I was 9 years old. There might be a picture, and they picked like three of us from the whole organization. Myself, another gentleman, a 9-year old, a kid like me, played French horn, and then like a 15-year old guy in the band, and he was like he had like the really the big. Like the marching band uniform, mm-hmm. we were just like in. Well, both of them have like the marching band uniform. I was like in the beginning band, so we just had like white shirt and tie.
Look at that little dude with the saxophone.
Picked us to go meet the mayor Bill McNichols, and so he was pretty cool. And the big photo shoot, press conference, whatever. And he was like, he never seen like a French horn before, so he was like, wow, this French horn. So it was really cool, like a real good experience.
And then you go into, like most people, high school, you start getting into and joining other bands.
Yes.
And you're doing the cover songs and the funk and the R&B and you're playing sax. So you did your junior high, you did the high school, you were in the ensembles and such, and then you go and you do your little funk pop band. What was the name of that band?
So that was called Mixed Company. So just before that, though, like, you know, all those years of Gold Sash Band, I still playing the horn, playing the sax. Then we got private lessons. Private lessons happened. So, and I was kind of getting good at it. So, and my brother as well. So we had private lessons, and then like start, and then like in high school, and in junior high, started playing the jazz ensemble, get my feet wet in the jazz. And it's like, yeah, I kind of like this. This is not too bad, but you know, I'm still like just a novice, beginner, newbie guy. So then like in high school, then, you know, I'm kind of getting a little better. Then, so some of my classmates like, Paul, this guy's pretty good. Let's get him in our band. And so we had just a hodgepodge of different people from our high school. And then a couple people were already a little older out of high school. Mm-hmm. And we formed a group called a funk band called Mixed Company. And so I had so much fun. And that really submitted myself for committing to a music career. Mm-hmm. And so we started gigging like in like clubs, bar mitzvahs, parties, home parties, kegger parties, they say.
The kegger.
Keggers. All that stuff, and then we got, you know, so good that we started playing clubs, and I was like, underage playing clubs at 16.
Of course, yeah, and, we all did that.
And then it was like, yeah, it was the funnest thing ever, so that it's like, I want to be like that. And then hearing Grover Washington and David Sanborn, Brecker Brothers, Earth, Wind & Fire, like, okay, I like doing this, but I want to be my own, you know, I want to be like them, like, you know, I want to be an artist like that.
So, what's great about this article I'm showing a picture of right now is your teacher had a premonition. So in this article, he says, now you're in high school, and he says, Paul Taylor is going to be a jazz great in the future. And he says that in the article. So he knew something. And then you talk about the Mixed Company. This is the band, Mixed Company. Look at him with the platforms and the bell bottoms.
Oh, yeah.
Paul's got his afro there in the back with the saxophone. That's classic old school. What year was that, if you had to guess?
That was 1977, I believe. I wrote on the back of the picture. So, yeah, that was 1977, I believe. So I was 17 years old, and this was a club in Denver, Colorado.
You were in the Denver Symphony. Was that before Mixed Company or during it or after it?
That, I believe, was like probably around the same time because, you know, I don't know, most people don't recognize this, but I also studied classical saxophone.
Mm-hmm.
And so... so I was working up a piece in high school. It's a well-known piece for saxophone repertoire. Mm-hmm. It's by Jacques Ibert. It's called the Concertina de Camera. So I worked on that and I learned it in high school. And so I guess I got good at it. And they had a concerto contest and I entered it. So I ended up winning the contest. And so the winner got to play the piece with the Denver Symphony Orchestra.
And this is the actual picture of that Denver Symphony with you performing. And if you guys can't see him, he's standing right by the conductor, and he's got his white suit and his saxophone on with the Denver Symphony. That's huge.
Yeah.
And then is this also the symphony, or is this the jazz band? What is this?
Now, this is in junior high, and great guy and great teacher and great friend. His name is Willie Hill. He was conducting. He's on the right, and so I believe that was like we did a concert like in the at the high school, and I think I was playing a solo, one of my first solos, like playing a jazz band solo, just in like a written solo that's already on the chart. So those were back in the days, big afro and everything.
Wild. And then, for some reason, you decide to come to Vegas. Was it college? Was it visiting the city with family first, or how did that happen?
So that came about like when you're like in the senior year, like, you know, the counselors, they talk with all the seniors and, you know, what are your plans for the future? And we can help you this and that and come have a conference with us. And we'll, you know, whatever way we can help you. And so, you know, obviously most kids, they want to go to college. So, and same here with me, like dad, my parents wanted me to go to college. And so, so we had our eyes on a few of the big musical universities like Berkeley,
mm-hmm.
Eastman School of Music. There's like Interlochen. There is North Texas State. So also UNLV came into the picture. So it was kind of weird that it's just so happened. So I put out, you know, got, you know, in that year, my dad helped me too, and mom, you get your interview, like the application's ready. It's right. Like all pages of stuff you got to fill out and stuff, and then get financial aid and what have you. And so they were helping me through that. And so So I had the strength of that concerto contest, that piece I had. So for the audition, I played that concerto, recorded it on a cassette tape, and I submitted that into, you know, all the schools. So what happened was pretty much got turned down from most of the schools. I think Berkeley, I probably could have went there, but it would cost too much for my parents to do that. But UNLV, on the strength of that tape, gave me a full scholarship, a full ride scholarship.
Dang.
So
I'm glad Berkeley didn't call you back, because then I wouldn't have met you. We wouldn't be hanging
right
out now.
That's right. So
there's a reason for things.
That's right. So we took that, and so that brought me to Las Vegas. And so at the same time, that in that senior year, like there's each year there's like all city band where they take there's like nine different public schools in the district. Mm-hmm. So they have a big contest and auditions. They take the best musicians from each instrument, and they form one big band, all-star band. So I was in that every year. So that year, we got a trip to go to Vegas, to UNLV, and so this was like a marriage made in heaven. Like, I'm thinking of going there. I can go there at the same time and look at the atmosphere and see what have you. They have their pros there playing for us. We played a concert for them. They had all the pro musicians play for us. So it was just like, this is like, it just all came together. So that brought me out to Las Vegas.
History since. So you're in the jazz ensemble at UNLV.
Yes.
And you guys, I never even heard of this until I was at your house one day and you showed me. You guys actually got to record. You got to go into a studio with your jazz ensemble and record albums.
Yeah, we did. Like, they had records even before I got there. And that's so crazy. And then, you know, they kept it going. We did After Midnight, I believe, the first year. We did one called Live in South America, UNLV Jazz Ensemble South America.
Look
Live
at that.
There we go.
See, I've been doing my research.
Oh, my brother.
See, some of these pictures, you know, Paul helped me out with, but he's busy. He's touring, he's rehearsing, he's recording albums, he's out in the streets playing golf. I don't know. But it's like doing homework. But there's so much stuff to unpack with Paul. I mean, this guy, like I said, 12 albums. We're still in the early years of college. Now, you guys... The whole ensemble went to South America and performed?
Yes. Oh, yes.
And did you record there or you just performed there?
We recorded that. We brought one audio guy. His name was Kurt Miller, I believe. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Kurt Miller came with us, and he documented everything and recorded everything, I think on Reel to Reel, and like all the concerts. And we put this album out. And so the really, really cool part about it, just seeing all the sites, like we went to like I'm drawing a blank. One of the highlights of the trip, we went to Peru.
Wow.
We went to Machu Picchu, like one of the seven wonders of the world. Like, hang out in Machu Picchu for the day. You take this long train up it, and it's like this really high altitude, and you get kind of like lightheaded because it's so high in the air. And hung there for the day. And then a couple of my buddies, like Byron Hamer and Jay Rasmussen, we brought our horns, and like, it was kind of like we started playing. We got in one of those little, got lost in one of the little catacombs up there, and we started playing our horns. And then, like, I guess you're supposed to like be kind of like respectful for the place. Mm-hmm. But you know, we're just like in college guys. We started playing our horn, like jamming on our horns for a little bit, like a couple minutes. And then I think the band director Frank didn't like that, so you know, cut that out. So that was a memorable part of that thing. But we went to like Sugarloaf Mountain, Christ the Redeemer, played all kind of different concerts, like in probably three or four different cities mm-hmm. in there, and. It was a really cool trip. So we went to like South America one time, one year. We went to Poland one year, and also we went to Spain. God. So it was the jazz ensemble program had a really good foundation, and had an internship program where they like each week, one of the students in the jazz band would go take the place of one of the pros on the strip when one of the shows, mm-hmm. and they would get the paid night off. And so that student gets that experience of playing in the pit band behind, like, it could be Liberace, it could be Dean Martin, it could be whatever, Lola Falana or whatever, you know, people back in those days. And so I did it myself, and invaluable experience.
See, in any other city, you probably wouldn't have those opportunities.
Oh, no, you have to wait. You have to, like, wait, got to, you know, get a gig there, you know, got to get the right place at the right time and all that stuff. But
did we have a mutual friend that was in this ensemble with you?
Yes, we do.
Who that?
Keith Nelson.
Keith Nelson. I've done about 9 episodes of and Paul Taylor and Keith Nelson's name probably came up in every one of them. It's a close-knit thing in Vegas. But I knew Keith Nelson from, he was in the same band I was in at El Dorado, the Sounds of the Sun.
Okay.
Hello, El Dorado alumni out there watching. Sounds of the Sun was a band, like most high schools had the jazz ensembles and stuff.
Right.
But in our high school, we got to play funk, and the students got to pick the songs. We were doing Earth, Wind, and Fire and Cool and the Gang and all that. But before I was in the band, when I was in junior high, Keith was in Sounds of the Sun, and they came to the junior high, and I watched them, and I said, oh, I got to get in that band. And I knew I was going to that high school because I was in the junior high, Del H. Robinson, that sent you to El Dorado. And that's how I seen Keith and seen Sounds of the Sun, and we ended up bumping to each other a few times, and then, of course, using them on the Dino projects and history ever since. Between him and you, we go back like an 8-track and a Cadillac with the seats back.
No doubt.
But he was in there for how many years with you in that ensemble?
He was there all the years. I got my degree in 4 years, but I stayed an extra year. I went 78 to 83.
Mm-hmm.
But I did get my degree, people, in my four years, but I stayed an extra year so to go on that South America trip.
Jeez.
So I took some extra classes. But I believe Keith was there for that entire time as well.
And so you both come out of college as astonishing, great, talented musicians, and you're in the city where, you know, it's a city of entertainment.
Yeah.
So you're getting in the bands, you're getting in the lounges, you're getting in the hotels. And one of the most popular bands I remember in the 80s was Jonathan and the Music Magic.
Oh, my goodness.
And you were in that group, right?
Yes, I was, yeah.
How many years were you in that?
That was about 3 years, give or take. Probably about maybe 3 or 4 years.
If you see, Paul is the one with the flat top haircut.
And like, it was a great experience and the great guys, and had a ball and learned a lot about show business as well. Like about just different aspects
performing
of the show business,
and
performing and all that, rehearsing and putting on a show. They were like the best guys, and we were like, you know, not no brag, but we were like the hottest thing in town. And like
I remember every
like the Maxim Hotel. Palace
Cloud
Station,
Nine Lounge,
Cloud
the
Nine
Maxim.
Lounge. Mm-hmm. We just like just packed them in every time, every night. So, just learned a lot from those guys, and then that, you know, ran its course and kept on moving.
So you got literally between UNLV and getting to record and being in a studio. I know that gave you the itch for like, man, this is what I want to do in life. I want to record and I want to perform.
Yes,
and then doing the Vegas bands.
Yes,
and sooner or later, you're going to become an artist. And, I mean, look at this promo picture right here. Woo! Paul Taylor, how old were you in that picture right there?
So that was, geez.
And what was that picture for?
You know, like, obviously, I was a musician in town. And
mm-hmm.
and then, like, you want to have, like, some headshot pictures for publicity. And so, you know, I had my eyes on being a performer, you know, an artist. So you got to have your pictures together and all, and what have you. So I, Yvonne Shahan, she really, really great photographer. She was married to Alexander O'Neill for a time. She did pictures for everybody, so I signed up to have a photo shoot with her, a couple of different photo shoots, mm-hmm. in fact. And so I got my pictures done with her just to have, some, you know, to be ready and to market myself. So that was in the probably 30 years old, in the 30s, early 30s.
And I think I remember the story, but I'm not sure.
Maybe late 20s.
How you met our friend Dino. Was that college? Was that at KUNV? Was that just as musicians? How did you meet Dino?
So I met Dino. So I was already out of college, maybe a year, just out of college, maybe a year out of college. And so So, you know, I spent like 15 years just paying dues doing those lounge bands. Mm-hmm. So anyway, like the first year, maybe first year or two, I met Dino through I think you know him as well, Dave Holt.
Okay, sounds familiar.
So yeah. Dave Holt, like, I got in a band with Dave Holt, and we had this little trio with Billy Young, myself, and Dave Holt. And so we played like around town. So then Dave knew Dino. So then Dino came to one of our things and said, hey, Paul, this is a good friend of mine, Dino Esposito. He's really good at music, man. Check him out. Like, he's a good guy. And it's like, met him and like, yeah, nice guy. And he, you know, listened to a couple of our sets and stuff. And so we just always just kept in touch. And so the relationship just grew. Like, I know he did like music and like he was really hip, like doing like the cool, you know, programming and mm-hmm. just to play keys. And, like, he could record. He had the 4-track. And, like, it's like, man, this guy's really good, man. Like, So we just like we just hit it off, like just really just a good friendship. And so, and then so like later on, he would have like some, hey Paul, like he knew I wanted to be like an artist, sax artist, and so Paul, I got some grooves, man. Do you want to like check it out? We can, you know, do lay down some tracks, whatever. And so we started doing that just lightly here and there, and then as the years went on, we did more and more, you know, to a point. And then we even like had a band. We Dino and I and a couple other guys. Okay, Dino Esposito, myself. Linwood Johnson, called him LJ, Emery Walker.
I remember Emery.
So we formed a group called, I know Dino's out there listening.
Hope he's listening.
Yeah,
oh, I got to look. Let's look at the comments. I got my friend Kevin on here, Gloria, great photographer. Gloria's in the building. We'll get to some of the comments. And you guys have any burning questions? You want to know where Paul's performing next time he's performing in Vegas? The comments are live. You could ask a question or leave a comment, and I'll try to pop some of them up here. But back to the story, I know what you're getting at. They had a band called Boys Next Door.
Yes, we did. We formed a group called Boys Next Door. So like just like some average guys next door. Like we rehearsing. We rehearsed for a little while, and then just in like I think Emery's house and garage and And we had like we got like PVC pipes and made like keyboard stands. These really clunky keyboard stands, and like we did like some originals. We did like some cover songs, like, you know, Word Up and different like Cameo songs and just whatever the really funky stuff at the time, and some jazz, some of my originals, and it was really fun. And then we did one gig. It was like just a one off gig, and it was like just real casual. And then just like. It just really never gelled. Like I was still trying to like we were all in different places at the same time and we try to get together, but you know, but some bands never happened, so it wasn't, you know, no hard feelings or nothing like that, but we just kept on going, and I kept on going with Dino as well, like relationship, and just kept on writing songs and stuff, and we kept doing more songs, and then some we met T-Bone. T-Bone's Sun Song Studios, and we would like sometimes I'd get a song and like, Dino, I have this really good song. I like the song. Check it out. Yeah, it's pretty cool. I want to save some money and go record it at T-Bone's. Would you help me?
T-Bone, look at Paul's haircut.
Yeah, Back to the Future.
This is backstage after one of our shows with Dino. I think it was when he did the Thomas and Mac and the whole Vegas clique come and hung out. But back to the Dino thing.
Yeah.
You end up with his recording stuff that he's doing, and you guys start recording some tracks, some jazzy things. I know he was into the jazz.
Yes.
And you did a song called Flight 808. I remember this was mid-80s. This is about the time I met Dino, too, and he had let me hear it in the car one day.
Wow.
That you guys recorded this thing. I said, man, this sounds legit. You know, of course, it's got the 808 drum machine and you playing. But you weren't originally on that track when you made it. And you said, I want to play on that.
He had the track already done, as far as I know. It's like on a 4-track. And, like, so this is the time, like, Najee just came out. And, like, man, he was a big influence as well. It's like, you know, Kenny G and everything like that. And, man, I know I can do this. Like, you know, I just got to keep working on it and working on it. So Dino had this track, you know, we called it Flight 808 because it had the 808, like, all through it. The 808, the TR-808 drum machine, the classic. So just really, you know, banging track. And so... So I, you know, he let me take it home and like work my stuff out, and then we did the session, and then, you know, it's on, and then like go figure, it's on. Like I put it on my Hypnotic CD, and we just kind of retooled a couple things. But so anyway, we did that song, and then like we just kept on going and did little projects here and there, and just a great guy, man. It's just, you know, I said if I ever make it to get to do some albums, I'm gonna have him produce me,
and vice versa, because. He ends up doing some of those recordings, and then me and him and Frankie get together in 86, and we do an electronic record. And I knew him just from KUNV as being a radio DJ. I didn't know that he had those keyboard skills.
Yeah.
And then when I heard him giving me those little jazz tracks, he said, man, I said, you need to play keyboards in this little thing we're doing. It's a little electronic group. You know, and we did like a Planet Rockish, Paul Hardcastle-ish electronic record called Defcon. We talked about it in an earlier thing. And then he got more of a bug, and then he did the Summer Girls 12-inch single, and then he got the deal on 4th and Broadway, and then it's time to record an album, and of course he's going to call Keith to do the bass, and he's going to call Paul to do the sax, and we had a great time recording that album.
Yes.
we called you over to where we were tracking at Jeff Lorber's house.
Man.
And you being a jazz musician, saxophone, we saying, guess what? You're going to record at Jeff Lorber's house. And you show up.
I couldn't believe it.
And later on, Jeff was so impressed with you and your playing and your style that after that session, he started inviting you to his shows and tours. He was doing that Catalina Jazz Festival, and he asked you to go on that. How was that to have a big guy like him say, hey, I want you to be included in this?
It was incredible. Like, first of all, doing that session, like playing on the 24-7, mm-hmm. the track, and then, Paul, here's a flight. We'll pick you up and come there, and all of a sudden, you guys are there. Jeff Lorber's right there. This freaking Jeff Lorber right there. So, like, you know, I had everything worked out, and I played, you know, did my part and played my song, played the solo, and everything went really well. And so, like, the seed was planted right there. So he heard me play, and then it took a couple years. But then, like, Dino kind of helped me, like, hey, if you need a sax player, Paul, you know, remember the guy Paul that played at your studios? He put in my song. Paul's available if you want. So it just, things just happened magically. You know, I really appreciate Dino up, you know, the bottom of my heart. Like, he, you know, somehow, you know, Jeff, like, oh, you know what, I'll give you a shot. And he had, like, the Catalina Jazz Tracks Festival. Actually, I'm playing that this next week.
Yeah, we're going to get to that. So that's only a couple weeks, 1 week away.
1 week away.
Yeah.
So he had, like, he was playing two consecutive weekends, and he did, and I guess he had an opening. So he gave me a shot. And so, you know, he gave me the, you know, far enough ahead, gave me the music and stuff. Oh, before that, I had to go to L.A., and, like, he wanted to hear me again. So we went a couple days early, and so he gave me his address and said, I'm over here in the, you know, I'm not gonna say where he lives, but so I went to his house, Pacific Palisades, exactly. Mm-hmm. So I went there. So, you know, the day before I had to do it, I made a dry run with my cousin-in-law at the time, and so we just to make sure, like, the next day I wasn't gonna get lost. Are you kidding me? This is like, I want to make sure I didn't get lost and get there on time and all that, and, you know, navigate L.A. and all that. I'm from Vegas. I have no idea mm-hmm. about L.A. So anyway, next day I'm there, right there, and play for him. He's in his living room, got the piano, and hey, just here, start playing, play along, whatever. So I guess I did all right. So he goes, all right.
You probably had his albums before you even met him.
Absolutely.
So you're performing in front of the guy that used to kind of idolize and
listen to his records. It's kind of a weird, like, when you see someone you idolize and you're like there and you're playing, like, hey, play.
And you're trying to play it off like, I'm a musician, I'm professional, but really you're giddy. And so when you do that jazz festival, the Catalina one, is that the first time you're in front of a crowd that big, you know?
Yes.
I know you're doing the Jonathan and the lounges, but thing is packed.
Well, but, you know, like, the biggest crowds were, like, touring with Dino, all those arenas. But, for, like, this was, like, the biggest, come to find out, the biggest, like, jazz event going at the time, and pretty much still is. So I get there and play within the first week. The first weekend we play, everything was really good. And, you know, a different story on that, we're playing one of the two weekends. So we're playing. So Dave Koz was there as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he might have had Dave Koz just there, like, in case Paul doesn't work out, like, you just come right in and, like, just fill in the, you know.
Right.
But anyway, so because Dave Koz came and sat in on the later in the set. And so, you know, I held it down really good. And so I remember playing next to Dave Koz, like, with Jeff Lorber, and, like, and he goes, yeah, man, you sound good, man. How old are you? And I told him, you know, my age, whatever. And so it was just a really good experience. And, like, what really blew me away, like, and then, like, we're rehearsing for those festivals. Mm-hmm. So we're in L.A. Then, like, in the midst of one song, you know, keyboard players, they have, like, the remote keyboard they pick up and, like,
right. Guitar.
The mm-hmm. guitar. And, the, mm-hmm. like, at the time, I don't think they had wireless MIDI, but, like, he had, like, a long cord on it. So he picked that up in one song. Then he picks it up and just goes over there and goes, Paul, come here. And, like, go to his keyboard.
You're in the
rig.
Live show.
Yeah. So, but it's at the rehearsal first, though.
Oh, okay.
So, like, you know, those ultimate support stands are, like, an A-frame. Right. He had, like, his stuff up there. So, or some kind of keyboard stand. He goes, Paul, come here. And so in the midst of the song, Paul, come over here. Dun, 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 dun. Here's the fingering.
I want you to comp. Like, he's doing keyboards.
He just had, like, here's the comping.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, what? And I just, like, I probably didn't do some of them right, mm-hmm. but, like, you know, I got the gist of it. And, like, I'm playing behind Jeff Lorber. I'm comping behind Jeff Lorber. There you
because
go.
I didn't even know that. I knew you as Paul Taylor saxophonist when we did the Arsenio Hall show, and we showed some of that footage when I had Dino on the episode, and you were on keyboards. And, like, I thought you were going to do the sax part. And then, he's playing keys, too. And
auxiliary.
We did a couple shows with Arsenio, and you do the keyboards, and a couple little shows where you did the keyboard on some little shows that we did. I was like, wow, this guy is talented. So that's 1989. We're doing the Dino album.
Yes.
I'm sure he used you on his other projects, but it's time to get into Paul Taylor, the solo career. So in 1995, you do your first album as Paul Taylor, the solo artist, saxophonist. Did they call it smooth jazz? Did they call it contemporary jazz? Contemporary urban jazz? Don't matter. 1995, you did On the Horn. That was your first album.
Right on.
Were you excited to get the deal and have your name on your own vinyl at that time, right?
Oh, my God. It was like what I worked my whole life up that to get to that point. And so, when the album came out, when the CD came out, you get a free box of them. And then from there, so I didn't even tell my parents. So then I wanted to wait till I had it in my hands. Mm-hmm. And so then I mailed my mom, my dad, my brother the CD. So I didn't even tell them. And so when they get in the mail, they see the CD, here I am. So, hopefully,
Did you end up doing, that album gets released, it's on some jazz radio. Do you end up doing shows out of that album, or does it take a few releases to get you out and doing shows?
No, absolutely. I was hit the ground running, and so I'll tell you that I wasn't really the most polished performer at first, and I still have a long way to go, I believe. But I was just playing lounges, and you're playing as a sideman to whoever the lead lounge singer is.
Up front guy.
Yeah. So now
shaking your butt.
Yeah. So I'm working all this time, and I never really funded my own thing. So sink or swim, and so I got. You just get busy with it and just play, and so play your songs. And I remember the first album, I only had 10 songs, 10 songs because the first album. So you got to play, whatever, how long you have to play your concerts. So I bolstered it with some other, some of the cover tunes to make it to fill in, to make it long.
All the jazz people did that.
So yeah, just did doing that. And so just right before I'll mention this, Rob, getting to that point. So playing with Jeff Lorber, those two weekends, Keiko Matsui was in the, she was there playing at a different time. So she heard the performance of Jeff Lorber. So one of those weeks she came backstage after we played and her and Kazu at the time, her husband at the time, right. And said we really enjoyed your performance. You're a really good player. We were fascinated with your performance. Maybe if later down the line, we would like to have you play. Maybe you could play with us if we have an opening in our situation. Mm-hmm. I go, sure. So
but this is before you had your solo deal.
Absolutely. Right. This is before the solo deal. Mm-hmm. So yeah, this is kind of important too. So those three people are the big break for me. Dino, Jeff Lorber, Keiko Matsui. So the Matsui saw me play there. So then it took about a couple years or two. So then I moved on to playing a really good showroom gig at the Rio.
Mm-hmm.
And man, the nicest people, Blair Farrington, Eunice Farrington, they put the show on called Conga. And
I remember Conga. You were in that show?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. And Brian was in it too. Brian and me, we were on the ground floor of it, and just had a ball doing it. And so Conga got off the ground. It was like a dinner show, dinner show on theme show, like Brazilian. Really cool show. And so then the Keiko thing was in the making. Then I only lasted 4 months on the Conga show, because then after a couple months, then Keiko called hey Paul, you remember us? We have an opening in our sax. Can you do some shows with us? We want to give you an audition. So then oh my God, I just started this showroom gig, and it had benefits and everything. So but got to keep your eyes on the prize. And so I went to Blair and the show just started 4 months earlier. And so it's this is my dream to go into this, to do this. So would I be able to get a sub for you or whatever? He said yes. He goes, you get a sub, get a qualified sub, and go check it out. And if it works out, then hey man, all the best to you. And if not, you can come back. Mm-hmm. That was most people, there's no coming back, So they were nicest guy, and just the nicest organization. So anyway, I did the audition with Keiko, and rest is history.
Doing shows with them.
Yeah, I did the whole shows with them.
You do get the album deal.
Yeah, so 2 years.
Some of the producing of some of the songs.
Yes, so I did 2 years with Keiko. So in the midst of that, I played with some special some private distributors kind of concert private. So I'm playing with her at some hotel in L.A. And then, like, I don't play every song with Keiko, so I play with her. The ones I don't, I just kind of go back on the side and just wait it out, out of sight. Then, so I did that a couple times. Then these gentlemen, these people would come one by one. How you doing? I'm from so-and-so Records.
There you go.
Give me the business card. I got six. I had a half a dozen business cards by the end of the night. So I was like, oh, my God. This is starting to happen. This is starting to happen right now. Right. It's happening. So one of the people was the label for Keiko, that Keiko was on.
Right.
So I ended up basically picking that label because I knew Keiko was doing it for them and all that. And I wasn't familiar with all the other labels and stuff, so I went with them. And so
keep it in the family kind of deal.
Exactly. So I got up with them. Unity Label Group. So then got my record deal, got signed in 94, but then the record came out in 95.
Right.
And so I said, so basically Kazu was going to produce it. So, and also another guy, Derek Nakamoto, did a lot of the programming on it. Mm-hmm. Great, great guy and great keyboard cordist. So, but I had to get Dino in there because, like, he meant so much to me. And, like, you know, we have that history together.
Got to pay it forward, pay it back.
That's right.
Put you on the map.
That's right.
And that's great that you did that because, you know, the record label or the producers says, no, we're doing the whole thing. And that you reached out and said, I got to have my guy do a couple songs.
I said, like, you know, there's two songs. And I already had Exotica. You know, I was always writing through all this time, like just writing in the bedroom, writing little demos. I had a 4-track, whatever. I had a, you know, Korg DW8000 keyboard, whatever, and just writing demos. So I did. I kind of got a good little groove on Exotica. Mm-hmm. So like, I got to get this song out. So, you know, I said like, hey. And also, Dino, at the time he worked with another guy named Scott Raymer. So they gave me some tracks, and so. That one of them was to be On the Horn, the title track. Mm-hmm. So I had that, and I gave him Exotica. So I said, you know, I got to have these guys do these two tracks. And then so it just all worked out. And so I had the most of it was produced by Kazu Matsui, and then the two tracks, Exotica and the title track, On the Horn, were produced by Dino Esposito and Scott Raymer.
There you go. And I'm going to tell you guys, he does – consistently, ever since that album, 95, every 2 years, year and a half, every 2 years, you did an album. Going on this 12th album that we'll talk about. But then there was Pleasure Seeker, which Dino did.
Absolutely.
And I did most of that album or all of that
album? They did all of it.
All of that album.
Yeah.
So
at that point, it was like, yes.
I'm just going to go through it. You can see what I'm showing here to the public, but these are his albums in chronological order. If there's anything that triggers you, a story or a certain song, you know, you can tell a story. But
so, okay, stop there on this one, Undercover. So on this one, so there was like, usually there's like about 2 years in between each album.
Right.
But on this one, After Pleasure Seeker, there was like it was like 3 years. So
yeah, because Pleasure was 97, Undercover was 2000.
Yes.
I put the dates on here just in case, you know, we want to get the chronological right. I'm very sticky about my chronological.
R-O-B.
So yeah, you skip 3 years, but hey.
So what happened in there, like, there was some label stuff, like, as in the music business, as everyone knows, in the business period, sometimes businesses get bought or, you know, another company
buys
them and all that. Yeah. So basically, I was in limbo for a little bit without a label. So, and then at that point, I got a management. So I got Andy Howard Entertainment. Andy Howard, I hope she's out there listening. But I got Andy Howard as a manager. So, so she was instrumental in getting me on a new label, which was with Carl Griffin, called. I'm drawing a blank on it, but I got on that label for Undercover as well as Peak. It was like kind of a joint label,
right,
with Peak Records, and then so. That really bridged the gap because it was like a 3-year gap, so they got Undercover.
Yeah, but I mean, some artists skip 4 or 5 years before they do another album. So you're still blessed to be doing an album every 2 years, every 3 years. Shoot, we'll talk about the big gap, but the big gap was, there's a reason for that. But I'm just gonna fly some of these other releases because this is when I was buying CDs, or if I seen you somewhere, you'd give me a CD. I got some of your CDs, but these albums are. There's always one or two things that were popping on these albums.
So on Hypnotic, so this has Flight 808 on it, the right. song that Dino and I did.
That's why I wanted to get to that, because you recorded that song
so long ago.
Late or early 80s with Dino just hanging out, messing around.
Yeah.
And then when you get to this album, you say, man, I want to revisit that song. So you guys kind of update it, remix it, and you put it back on here. So it's crazy how absolutely. Things go in cycles like that.
Yes, and we recorded some of it at, I recorded my sax at T-Bone Studio.
Yep. We talk about T-Bone all the time.
Yep.
Boom. Another album. Now we're up to 2003.
So on Stepping Out. So, this is pretty long ago now, so I'm not sure if Dino's on this one. So I got, some other producers came into the fold.
Right.
And so there's a myriad of other producers that I worked with, like Rick's Rideout mm-hmm. and Barry Eastman, I believe, on this one. So we did... Stepping Out and kept on going. And
sometimes it's beyond your control as an artist.
Yes.
If you have a certain label that has a track record with producers, they can say, hey, here's the deal. Here's the advance. But here's the producers we want to use. I know you got people, but let's do this. Let's try this. But you can always revisit later, and you did revisit several times. And I know your current album that's coming out was all Dino.
Yes, right. So, and you know it.
I mean, so what? He couldn't get every album. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Then we're over here to Nightlife, which was 2005.
Now we got Dino back in the mix, as well as some other producers. It's like a multi-producer produced. It's multi-produced, and I'm just like in the just doing my thing,
every
and like
two
you know,
years.
Then you know, getting
at
Nightlife
this point,
going.
Is it called smooth jazz when you're on the chart itself? Did they call it smooth jazz? Because I remember it was called contemporary jazz or modern jazz, or and now this whole thing is starting to change where there's just calling it C jazz, because people said there was a funk with the name smooth jazz.
Yes, but yeah, when I got in it was smooth jazz. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad I got in at the time I did in 95. It was like kind of in its heyday for several years after that, and they had like R&R magazine, they had Gavin magazine, mm-hmm. the weekly all the reports. So I had to start getting number, like every album has number one songs on it.
That's right.
I have number one songs on and every pretty much every album. And then so eventually, smooth jazz. There's my
Lady's Choice.
There we go.
Talking about magazines and number ones. This yes. went number one on the Billboard Contemporary Jazz Album Chart, 2007. Now I remember this song like crossed over. I mean, I remember hearing this song on urban radio.
You know, it did like it didn't get like in the top 10 or anything like that, but it did cross over exactly. Yeah. So, I was like, just happy. Everything's happening, So, Lady's Choice. And I got to work with a legendary producer named Barry Eastman. Mm-hmm. Got to fly out to New York. He's like upstate New York in Tarrytown and work with him. And so we, and the same as well as on Burnin' with him and Rick's Rideout. And funny thing on Burnin', so I'm flying out to work with Barry Eastman.
Right.
And so, My alto got jacked up on the plane somehow. Oh. When I got off and I brought it and I was like, I'm at his place and I'm playing it, then like wouldn't play, like all kind of leaks and everything. So I brought all three horns. I brought my soprano, alto, and tenor. So I just got like, well, the alto's not good right now. Let's go ahead with the tenor and a little bit of soprano maybe. So let's record some songs on tenor. Maybe it could be like a
whole different take, whole different
like a whole
vibe,
thing. Yeah. Like when you make an album, it's like one thing. Like already, right. We're gonna set it do just like this. Right. So we did like pretty much all tenor record, but there is one alto song on it. So we did Burning with that, and
you just say, hey, let's go to the Guitar Center or whatever it was back then. Let's just go get a horn since mine's busted. You just say, make do with what we got.
I probably should have should have got my alto fixed too, but no regrets. But we did it was kind of a theme record with the tenor, mostly tenor. Yeah.
That's good.
So Burning was like one of the
something, and it actually was a whole different vibe, whole different sound.
Absolutely. So Burning was number one hit as well.
Man, you were killing on these albums. Just they're so catchy. You always get this. I mean, even when we used to rehearse, we'll talk about it. But when I did the Funk All Stars, I said, "Paul, if you can join us on some shows, that would be dope." And you're busy. You're touring. You're this and that. But I had some pretty fun shows, and our mutual friend Keith Nelson's in it. And Paul, you didn't have to ask him twice. He said, "Oh, I'm down. I'll come over to your house and I'll learn the songs." And I said, "You don't have to learn them. You know all these. These are all funk and R&B hits, and just refresh your memory. Boom, boom, boom." But you're great at these little catchy melodies. Even when we're rehearsing, you'll start doing a lick. and you'll say, Rob, record this real quick. And I have my iPhone out. Record this lick. I might use this lick. Because
that's how we do it.
The kind of musician you are. That's dope.
And we're that was so fun doing those. That was I had a ball doing those, man.
Yeah, we're going to show some footage. For those of you who missed the Funk All-Stars with Paul Taylor, I'm going to show you some footage. I just want to show this track record of albums, catchy songs, Tenacity, 2014. Great.
Yep.
And this is the album that was out when you started doing the show. So of course, when Paul's on stage, I said, listen, I got the one and only Paul Taylor on stage with us right now. You need to go check out his album on iTunes, Countdown. Great album, and you should have brought some. You could have sold them right off stage.
Because
as soon as he came out on stage, people were screaming. It's like, how'd you get Paul Taylor? I said, I've known him for a long time, so...
Awesome. And you're playing, and I had known you played drums.
Oh, you didn't all this time?
I don't think so.
Oh, that's weird.
And then you get on the Wheels of Steel, and then you're playing drums. You're just rocking it, keeping it going, man.
And keep talking about Dino. So let's go ahead and show a picture of the process when Paul and Dino work together. Then they have to take it to a mastering facility. All these albums.
Oh, nice. Bernie Grundman.
Bernie Grundman. One of the best people in the people who are into the musicians and the recording and mastering, Bernie Grundman is one of the biggest mastering guys. And this is the guy you take it to when you record your album and you think it's perfect and everything sounds good and you put the order together. Then you go to this guy and he masters it. And when I say he masters it, he EQs it, he compresses it. He might even say, oh, this order needs to be this way and the volume and the EQ. And it's a lot of technical stuff. But the fact that you had Bernie Grundman mastering your stuff. It's huge.
Exactly.
I wish I would have had a master of my stuff.
And so he did like the next several of them. And so it was really cool to go there and just hang with him for a while. He's just a really down-to-earth guy and makes you feel right at home and have different stories and stuff and spend an hour or two in there and do it. And Andy would come in, my manager would come in too, and just we'd sequence the song, sequence the record, and just do the thing.
Dope stuff. So listen, guys. We went through those 11 albums, and he's got a 12th album. We're gonna talk about that. But while we're on the subject of the Funk All-Stars, I want to show you what Paul lent to my band. I mean, the dynamic of having him on stage and doing sax parts is great. So here's a little piece of our show from like 4 or 5 years ago. Check this out, guys.
Come on. Yeah.
So once again, thank you for helping us out. We did some Aliante shows, some Silverton shows, MGM, and you can't do those songs without those sax parts. You know what I'm saying?
I'm like, thanks for inviting me. I had a ball. It was like totally fun.
It was an honor having Paul Taylor, who's got 12 albums out, come play with us. Tell me, I'm telling you, it was dope. And people were like I said, they were saying, how'd you get Paul in there? So we do the Funk All-Stars, and we also do these corporate shows. And like I say, Paul's busy, and it you'd think it'd be beneath him to do corporate shows. He's got all these albums out, and I wouldn't ask him to do the scrubby ones, but we had some big ones. We do shows for Nissan or do shows for Microsoft and whatever. And me and Keith, who we mentioned 1,000 times, I have this little DJ sax bass trio. And we do that once in a while. And the agency will give us our funky little outfits. Let me see if I got...
Oh, yeah, those gold jackets.
Yeah, I'm going to try to find that picture.
Yeah.
Where was that at? That was way down here. We're looking like the Temptations over here. But fun money stuff. Good times. We get to play.
Absolutely.
I got these jazzy instrumental things, and we even play some of Paul's instrumentals, and he plays on them. Oh, we have a great time doing it, so appreciate you doing that too. And you're going to be too busy to do that pretty soon with the new album.
Remember when we did one and we met Shim Lim?
Yeah, that was that came up on my memory.
Oh my God.
2 years ago.
That guy
before
was,
the pandemic, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to go into the pandemic because I talked to a bunch of entertainers. I talked to Eddie Fluellen about it. I talked to Michael Cooper about it. Us as entertainers, our nervous energy, we want to be out there entertaining. We were forced to not entertain. And when I say he's had albums every two, maybe once in a while, every 3 years, but mostly every 2 years he had an album out. This new album was almost 3.5 years. We had to subtract that crappy year.
Yes.
So he probably would have had it out last year about this time. But
Absolutely.
Because of that, and plus your shows, even when you're not doing an album, you're still doing shows, and you had to stop doing that. So
how
did you feel about it, and what's your reaction, and how did you manage and cope with that?
So... there's an addendum to that, ROB. So besides COVID, like another one of those business things came into play. I was on E1 Records, Peak E1. So let me see if I got it right. E1 got us bought by another conglomerate, I believe. They got bought by a big company.
It happens all the time. Like
so
you
then,
said,
like
the
you know, then I'm in the middle, you know, in the limbo without a record deal. So that is as well. So then COVID happened. So then, you know, how I got through that was just I had enough resources to get through it, and I didn't really, doing those live streams wasn't really my thing at the time. And so I did do a couple of recording live on video. I record them on my phone.
Right.
You know, I had to get the sound right and stuff like that.
Just so fans could see you doing something.
And then when I played like drums and stuff on it and played my sax and did a little tribute to Bill Withers. He passed away during that time. And I did a couple videos like that. And then a super fan in Japan in that time learned of me and like started like just, wow, like her name is Hiromi. And maybe she's watching now. That give her a shout out. She's just out of the bottom of her heart just doing all these promotional like videos and like just, Paul Taylor's the greatest. Paul, you know, these really nice like multimedia little like short little videos and stuff, and that kind of kept me going and stuff like that. And so I did a couple videos for her, and then she put them out on her page. And so that's kind of how I got through it. And then finally, then it kind of like earlier in the year, it kind of started to loosen up, and you know, here we are now, like starting to do gigging.
I had the nervous energy, and this was exactly this was about April or May of 2020 when things got shut down, and I said, let's do a Facebook Live of kind of what we do with those corporate shows. I called Keith over, and I called you over, and I didn't have to ask him twice. That's how these talented musicians, it's great having talented musicians as friends. So I said, let's do a Facebook Live, and let's do a little 45-minute hour set of our things so people can have some entertainment, because this is when people were, the streets were locked down, quarantine style. So I'm going to give you guys a piece of that. Just because I want some music and some entertainment. I know you don't want to see us stare at us talking the whole time. So here's some other footage of us doing that little pandemic quarantine show here at my house. This is like a minute or so. Check it out. This is me acting silly, but...
R.O.B.
Mm-hmm. that was fun. Absolutely. Fun to watch. It was fun to do that.
Absolutely.
And
it was last year, right?
Yeah, that was about a year and a half ago, like May of 2020. Yeah. Everybody called me after, man, you guys got to do that more often. Shoot, that's a lot of work. And
yeah,
tough to get people together. And mm-hmm. I was scared to even have people in the house. I was like, oh, they haven't been nowhere. I haven't been nowhere. But that was pandemic time. And interestingly enough, with the pandemic, and it's time for Paul to record his 12th album, which is called And Now This.
And Now This.
And it's coming out November 5th. You guys had to record a little differently. You did this during the pandemic, so you're recording your parts at home, sending them to Dino.
Yes.
He was sending you stuff back and forth, and you finalized an album by doing it that way, which a lot of musicians are doing now anyway. Technically, it's mm-hmm. you're capable of doing that now. Mm-hmm. So how was that experience compared to all the other albums?
It was a little different at first, and then but then after too long, we just got in the groove of doing it. So it was like maybe the hardest part was like me just get like, you know, have a studio and then just getting like the some settings. Of my equipment was a little mm-hmm. bit. I had to get like raise my my equipment up to date and get the right sound, because like he needs to get the tracks in a certain way of the sax. So just once we got that going, then it just like hit the ground running and just like bouncing tracks back and forth. And we did We Connect, the website, and change files and just you know, it usually we like rework really fast, and so it's kind of weird, like, you know, when you have like Rob, like when you have like a lot of time, sometimes like you don't want to like take too long,
right?
But like it took a little while, like we kind of took our time a little bit. Mm-hmm. So but after a while we're like, well, let's get this going, let's get it, this kind of right. Let's kind
of
wrap it up
first. It's a luxury of, oh, we can take the time, yeah, because there's not a date yet set for the album release, so we can take our time and do it right. At the same time, you got the nervous energy, you don't want to lose momentum of the ideas and the way the whole album's going to sound, and
right,
when it gets spaced out like that, you start losing your enthusiasm.
Exactly. You know? You don't want to take too long. So like, right. So then we wrapped it up and got it going, and then come to find out like, well, we can get it out this year. So like, let's get it going and get it mastered and mixed and all that. And everything happened, everything happened the way it was supposed to happen. And I'm so blessed to have, you know, this, you know, And Now This coming out on November 5th. So
and there it is. There's the artwork.
There it is.
That's Paul Taylor, And Now This. Now, that comes out November 5th. Check it out on iTunes, all your other platforms. You can buy this night. Please, you guys. It took them a while to do this album with the pandemic. The rewards are you guys purchasing this, supporting his shows that are coming, we're going to talk about. But the single came out a few weeks ago. Now, check this out. The first single is called Straight to the Point, and it was number one added on Billboard's Smooth Jazz Radio chart, which means when that song was released, all these jazz radio stations jumped on it immediately. They were itching for some Paul Taylor. So number one on radio ads is a huge. It's just going to show you what the momentum of the album is going to do. You know what I'm saying? So I'm going to put Paul on the spot. I don't know if he knew this. Maybe he knew this. Maybe it's not a surprise. Maybe I'm just joshing with everybody. But I got Paul Taylor here, obviously, and he's got a brand new album and a new single out, and I want you guys to hear it. So I could either play the song or he could do it here live. I think I got something here. Let me see what this is right here. Look at this.
What?
I found this in the streets. Think you could play this?
What do you got there? You'll see what we can. Let's see what we can do
this
with that.
This is a beautiful saxophone. So check it out, y'all. This is impromptu. This is live. As you know, I have this little video podcast studio. We rearranged some things. Half of this room is what you're looking at. The other half is a green screen. So we got the saxophone dialed in, and we're going to have Paul perform his new single, Straight to the Point. This is already out, and of course the album, and now this comes out November 5th. So you guys are in for a treat. If you join this DJ RB Presents Taking It Back, you're in for a treat, because we've got Paul Taylor performing live right now, right here. Let's see how this goes. This is going to be crazy, you guys. want you leaving. I got another one for you.
Alrighty.
That's your brand new single.
Brand new.
Now I want to hear that Lady's Choice. We're going to do one more for you guys. This is Lady's Choice from 2007. Check this out.
We'll be right back.
Now that was a free treat for you guys out there in Facebook Live. Thank you. Thank you, Paul. Let me get back to normal scenes here. Hold on here. All right. There it is.
That was fun.
So tell them the name of the album, the name of that song, the first single that's out. And then we're going to talk about the tours and we're going to wrap this up because, yes, the album's out. So he's going back on tour.
Right on, ROB. My new album is called And Now This, November 5th. You guys, everybody, it's going to be out then. So you get your pre-orders in. The song I played was the first single called Straight to the Point.
And he was straight to the point. So if you guys never seen a Paul Taylor show, I mean, you got a little hint just now. You got a little hint. But I'm telling you, next week he's going to be at the Catalina Jazz Festival.
Exactly.
With his the act is called Sax to the Max. Tell him who's involved with that.
We have a great package tour called Sax to the Max. Definitely headed by Michael Linkton, then with Vincent Ngala and myself. And we're just going to throw down at Catalina. Like, I played there probably a dozen times. So over the years, playing there, it got my big break there. So always a great. So it was a thrill going there, coming back there. So we're going to do it up right next week, a week from today, in fact.
If you want to see what Sax to the Max looks like, or you want to see what Paul Taylor live on stage looks like, here's another teaser. I'm giving you some teasers today. Check this out, you guys. So now you know what it looks like, what it sounds like. So that's next week. The Catalina Jazz Festival is next week with yes. Sax to the Max. Let me show a couple of these promos and talk about what else you got coming up. Obviously going to tour, but some of these shows that you know are in the next week or two, and I'll even pop some of the flyers up.
Thanks so much, RB. So after next week on the 28th, 29th, 30th, I have Chicago smoothchicago.com. I'll be in Chicago for their O'Hare Jazz Fest 2, I believe. So I'll be there on the end of October. And just missed Halloween, I'm playing. So then after that, then we're going into November. Then we have the album release on November 5th, And Now This. And then, we have the Daytona Jazz Weekend. And it'll be the second. We played there earlier in I think May. So they're having another one, and I'm so privileged to be on in November. So we'll be heading up there to do that, and that's going to be Sax to the Max as well.
Wow!
So we'll be doing that there, and then I have a solo show in Galveston, Texas, on November 21st. So that's all I can tell you right now.
So there you go. Paul is busy. You know. The album's going to be in full effect for 2022. So in 2022, you're going to be busy.
I love it.
Is probably the last time I see Paul Taylor until maybe Christmas when I ask him to come to the house and do my Christmas party.
All right.
But, man, what a pleasure talking to you. I always get so involved with talking in the history and the albums that there was a lot of people in the comments, but you can watch this back later. Thanks, you guys, for tuning in. Once again, bottom of my heart, great friend. Thanks for doing this with the schedule as busy it is, album out, tours, rehearsals. He stops by for almost an hour and a half. So thank you for coming. I hope you had fun, but
it
was a pleasure having you on Facebook Live. They're all thanking you. You actually did a performance. So any last words?
Love you, ROB. Thank you so much for having me. And thank you, all the fans out there listening. And Dino.
Dino, shout out, Dino. Hope Keith you're watching Nelson, this.
T-Bone.
Keith.
Keith. Gosh, all the, you know, Mixed Company. Jonathan Music Magic. All those people out there. Keiko. What's up, you guys?
That's it. Thank you, Paul. That is Paul Taylor, one of the biggest smooth jazz artists, contemporary jazz, contemporary urban jazz. Please go check out the album. Go to iTunes. The single is out now. November 5th, the complete album comes out. Wait, I got to talk about this. As a DJ working in clubs that I do, last year, about a year and a half, 2 years ago, there was a song by Regard called Ride It. Big dance house song. Ride It. You guys got to look it up. And Paul loves all kind of music. I knew we were about to sign off, but I got to say this. Paul loves all kind of music. Like when I go DJ, like thank you for coming to the old school party. You came last month to the old school party. He loves old school hip hop. He loves dance music. He loves jazz. He loves funk. He loves pop. I looked at his album collection at his house. I mean, he's got a wide repertoire of musical taste. And this new album, he did a cover song of Ride It by Regard. Now that's dope. A contemporary jazz artist took a house song, flipped that genre into jazz, and he let me hear it because it ain't out till November 5th, but I got a sneak peek. I'm not going to let you guys hear it, but I got to hear it. It is dope. So for those of you who know the club music, this album is a treat for everybody, not just your jazz enthusiasts, but there's dance music. There's a house remake of, like I said, Ride It by Regard. Dope. So brave of you and smart of you for doing that.
Thank you.
I think we know somebody gave you an idea of doing that song, yes, so shout out to them as well.
Exactly.
But any last words? That was supposed to be the last word. Any other last words?
Thank you so much, ROB, for having me. I love doing this, and man, just all the thanks in the world for you doing this, and thanks everybody out there. And you know, look for my And Now This on November 5th, pre-order as well.
There it is, another episode in the books with Paul Taylor. Thank you guys for tuning in. We'll see you on the next episode, and peace.